Well, that's the biggest thing right there, effort. I saw a lot of guys give up. I mean, you can't even say they were playing hard. You know, to think that this team didn't give up on Chip this weekend, you have to be crazy if you don't think they didn't. I mean, guys were still – there were a couple guys still fighting, but for the major part of that team, they weren't out there giving their all. They weren't even out there giving 100% for Chip or themselves.
Yeah, and you know, there's a couple of things. Let's start on the offensive side of the ball. They just continue to struggle on offense. You know, it's hard to say that the team has quit on offense or the effort on offense because their offense has been bad all year long. Do they have – if they ran – put it this way. Some people think, well, if Chip Kelly left, you know, that sets everything back and you got to start all over. But if they had a guy who had more NFL principles in a different scheme, do they have talent on offense that is – winnable talent? Could you win games with some of the guys that you have here if you ran a more NFL-esque style?
No. The offensive line, there's too many deficiencies in the offensive line. There's too many deficiencies at the receiver position. If you look at it, these guys aren't and do not have the capability to run on any type of offense. At this point, the offensive line, as far as Matt Tobin and Dennis Kelly, aren't starters in the NFL. I don't think they'll ever be starters in the NFL. And right now, they're projected to be starters. They are starters each week. So when you have guys like that that can't block one-on-one, can't stop a rush or drive anybody off the ball, then how do you expect to win a game in the NFL?
Let me ask you your opinion on a couple of things here on these moves, some offseason stuff. To me, Barrett, all right, they made the Bradford trade. You could say that worked out. It didn't work out. We'll get into that. The Murray signing. You know, Maxwell has been a disaster. Letting Macklin kind of go here, and I want to get your opinions on that. But to me, the Evan Mathis thing has completely blown up in their face for a couple of reasons, Barrett. One, if he's your left guard, you then have a competition at right guard, two guys battling out that for that position instead of those two guys getting handed positions. And two, I really think that set a bad precedent in that locker room that they never gave Evan the chance to prove that he wasn't going to show up. So that one, above all the other moves, I think hurt them the most.
Absolutely. You know, he was going to come up for the mandatory camps. We're talking about mandatory, not the involuntary camps. Involuntary means you don't have to go if you don't want to. Because you stepped to Chip Kelly and you didn't do what Chip Kelly wants you to do, you were against his culture. So, you know, he didn't allow him to come back. And it was actually, you know, something that Chip Kelly had to do because he had set the precedent by letting Shady go in the trade, by not signing back guys like, you know, DeSean Jackson. Because he was that guy and he set that precedent, he had to follow up with Mathis being that guy and not falling under Chip's rule at that point.
Yeah, I mean, and Mathis, look, he was a guy that I think, you know, was well-liked in there. And have you been in a situation where a guy who was well-liked was just let to walk? Similar to what, I mean, they just cut Mathis. They didn't even give him a chance. I mean, how does that impact the locker room when something like that happens?
Never seen it in my life. I've never witnessed anything like that, especially at the NFL level when results are the ultimate parameter on whether a team is going to keep a player or not. There have been plenty of players that just don't fit a culture that aren't necessarily guys that, you know, a coach would like to have on our team. But the end result is production on the field, and I think Mathis would have got it done. It would have been a lot less hassle as far as from an offensive standpoint because you can open up a lot more with Mathis at left tackle and Alan Barber at the right Mathis at left guard and Alan Barber at the right guard position. Barber has been okay. He's been solid, but there's no way that Tobin should be on an NFL team and Dennis Kelly either. Those are just big guys. They can't move. They're not aggressive enough. They're not physical enough. And, I mean, I can sit down and watch film with these guys any day, and we can go through. We can watch my film, see how I played, watch their film, see how they played. I wouldn't mind doing that. I'm telling you right now, they should not be on this roster, not good enough to play on this team.
All right, Barrett Brooks is with us. Letting Jeremy Maclin walk. I think a lot of the people at the time thought it was a foregone conclusion that Maclin was going to come back. But I think it's a move that really has hurt this offense a lot. How do you look back at that? I said earlier, and people are kind of, you know, saying that they had no choice. He chose to go sign somewhere. But could the Eagles have prevented Maclin from walking by approaching him in season and saying, look, you're really playing well this year. We wanted you back here, and approached him in the season last year? Or do you not find fault with the Eagles for letting Maclin kind of get away?
That deal should have been done halfway through the year. They should have brought him to the table, knowing the fact that they don't have anybody else on that team, especially at a proven that is proven enough to be that dynamic receiver. And to be honest with you, Macklin is not a dynamic receiver. He's a solid receiver, a receiver that's good in this offense, a receiver that understands how to run the offense. So that's what he brought to the table. He's not one of those players you would say that was anywhere at the caliber of a Calvin Johnson or even a Larry Fitzgerald. But he's a solid guy that played solidly for Chip Kelly and is now playing solid for Andy Reid. So, I mean, by no means am I saying that he's an impact player like Deshaun Jackson, but he is good enough to run this system, take the top off of defense, and have in this offense defensive coordinators worrying about where he is, as opposed to now they don't care what receivers anywhere else. They just go out there and play defense, solid defense against this team, and you can stop them every time. All defensive coordinators have to do is run cover two and bump and run on the receivers up front, just, you know, alter the routes a little bit. And then these guys, you know, they can't get open. They can't create separation. So the lack of talent at the receiver position is one of the major factors, second only to the offensive line.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like, you know, they were willing to give Murray money. They were willing to give Maxwell money. They paid $13 million for Bradford, but they weren't willing to go maybe a little bit over what they should have spent for Macklin. But don't you do that to keep your own guy. Sometimes you got to give your own guy a little bit more to show that appreciation in the locker room.
Absolutely. You know, it's the intangibles that this guy brought to the equation, the intangibles of being a team player. Guys liked him in the locker room. You know, he brought something to the table as far as, you know, his offensive ability and his off-the-field abilities. See, I just don't understand why they didn't keep, you know, either one of those guys, Matthews or keeping, you know, Jeremy Macklin. Macklin was a good guy, you know, but so was Mathis, you know, but I hadn't seen a team turn on a guy like they turned against Mathis. You know, that was big to me also.
Yeah, no doubt. And then, of course, when you bring in guys like Miles Austin and Cooper, another thing that bothers me about this whole situation, Barrett, and I don't know if we talked about this before, but, you know, you got Cooper and Austin, two guys who have done nothing for you, and the Eagles, to my knowledge, all season long, haven't brought in any suitable guys to try out or, you know, I'm not saying you had to sign Welker or sign Hakeem Nicks or sign any of these guys, but to at least open your guy's eye to say, uh-oh, I'm on alert here. Meanwhile, Dorum Boss has one bad game with two bad snaps, and they brought two guys in to try out for his job on that next Monday. And it's like, where's the accountability for the fact that these guys are not performing?
Well, you know, Miles also knows that he's playing on borrowed time. You know, he understands his shortcomings in his game, and you know, he's basically just you know, out there just collecting the check at this point. You know, he's bringing nothing to the offense as far as explosiveness. You know, his route running has been less than what has been in the past. He doesn't run full speed through his routes. Those are things that you could actually handle yourself and become better at if you did it, but they haven't, you know, and that's the problem. These teams aren't taking it to another this team isn't taking it to another level and playing beyond what they can play. And that's what, you know, makes you a better team, you know, and that's what made when I won the Super Bowl with the Steelers. We didn't have a bunch of guys that were great, talented players, but we had enough guys that were going to go out there and kick your butt, you know, enough guys going to go out and fight you every single play, which made us a better team in that aspect.
Yeah, all right. Byron Maxwell, what did players make of these kind of deals when you're on a roster and this guy gets $10 million? Look, it seems like it's a hype buy. Guys get overpaid. That's what happens. It's a bad personnel decision, but this is sometimes what these deals are in free agency. Do you feel like sometimes there are resentment towards a guy like this where our players like, hey, he got what he got, but he has not performed up to that deal?
Well, he got him. You know, he got $63 million, and that was probably the biggest robber I've seen thus far in free agency. You know, he played away in a position that, you know, he won. You know, he played just well enough with Seattle and with those guys in that in you know, that defensive backfield. He played good enough to win a $63 million contract. This by far is even worse than Marcus Smith.
Is he a bad player or is it a bad scheme fit for him? I mean, why has he been basically given this team zero impact?
I think it's a little bit of both. it's got to be a little bit of both. You know, he's not good enough to run the defenses that that Davis wants to run at this point, but he also is not good enough. He hasn't played well enough to even customize a defense that would put what he does good in front of the on the field. I can't see in any way why he has played so bad, you know, considering the way he played last year when he was with Seattle. I mean, is it that much of a difference in, the caliber player you have playing around you that you can get over on a team like this? This is like highway robbery. Now, I'll never fault a player from getting their money. You know, you got to get your money. But this is definitely one of Chip Kelly's worst picks, as far as bringing a guy in ever. This might be the worst thing the Eagles have ever done. This is worse than Osmore. You know, that's how bad this signing is.
Wow. What about Murray? I mean, it seems that if you go back through the Murray thing, they wanted Gore. That didn't work out. And it was almost like they impulse buyed at that point. It was like, well, now I really want something. I got to go get it. And they got enamored with the name where they had, Gore and Matthews coming in on a lot cheaper deals. And look, I said, I don't have a problem if you trade McCoy. You saved almost $8 million in cap space. But then you went and blew that by going to go get Murray. So the Murray deal is something that really hurt this team in the offseason.
Well, Murray, if you look at film from last year and watch film of this year, he still has the same explosiveness and speed that he had last year. He was never that fast guy, that explosive guy that we thought he was just because he was a rushing champion. He was a product of the offense that they ran and the offensive line that they had last year. He really wasn't that fast. I watched film from last year, and I watched film from this year. He's doing the same things. He just didn't have the offensive line that he had behind him. They hit a lot of his flaws. They hit out a lot of his inefficiencies. So now, they're reaping the benefits of, or I can't say benefits, they're reaping what his true talent is. He's never been a burner, so I think that, he's giving you exactly what he did last year. He's just not as good as we thought he was.
And the hard part is the Murray Matthews, when you brought those two guys in and you got rid of McCoy, that's $23 million in cash now over the next 2 years. McCoy would have been $17.4 million. But basically he would have been done, and you now have $23 million in guarantees between Matthews and Murray, where you would have just had $1 million in guarantee after next year for McCoy. So they have put themselves in a hole with the replacements for McCoy. That's where, to me, they really bungled that whole situation. So some of the offseason problems are going to hamstring this team moving forward. Here's a question for you, Barrett. On defense, okay, they've got Cox and Logan and Thornton up front. They've got the linebackers Barwin and Graham, who they just gave contracts to. They've got Alonzo, Hicks, and Kendricks and Ryans. You've just gave $63 million to one corner. You drafted another one in the second round. You've got Jenkins, and Thurman is a free agent. Where on defense can they improve under that scenario?
I'm going to tell you the truth. Yes, this defense has not played well in the past, two and a half, 3 weeks. I'll give you that. But this isn't a thing where it's not necessarily the defensive line is this really making this defense bad. I think that, the linebacker position, especially inside linebacker position, is where their deficiencies are. They aren't reading well. They're not being instinctive as defensive linebackers. They're not attacking up front. They're playing very, very soft in how they're playing the game. Their approach is very, very soft. So where do you go from here? They're supposed to be the heart of the defense. They make all the calls. They're not making these impact tackles they need to play well. When Hicks left, he was their impact tackler. He was a guy in which they needed him to attack downhill, and he showed these older guys how to attack downhill. Because he's been gone, there's no coincidence since he's been gone that the defensive production has also left and gone out the building also. So they need players that can attack downhill. Kiko Alonso, you traded for Shady McCoy. Who got the better deal out of that? Even though Shady isn't playing as well as he did here, he is showing that, progress now. We haven't seen any progress in what Kiko Alonso was doing.
All right.
He looks like he's lost out there at this point.
Your thoughts on this team moving forward? Have you basically written this team off? We all know that they are mathematically right in the thick of this thing. They play New England. They still have the Cardinals coming up, but they do have two games in the division with the Redskins and the Giants. And, of course, they got that matchup with McCoy and the Bills. Is this team, in your opinion, have they checked out, or do you think there's still a shot?
There's no shot at them doing. I don't think there's a shot at them doing, but I will say this. Since they're mathematically still tied in, maybe these guys collectively as a team turn things around as far as their attitude and make it a little close. I can't see them winning the division at this point because they're just not – they don't have the intestinal fortitude right now to go out there and impose a will on their will on anybody. They're getting dogged out. They're getting pushed around. They're getting manipulated by guys that shouldn't even be out there on the field with them, and they're getting beat by guys that shouldn't be beating them. So – I don't give them a chance of doing it right now, but maybe they need to hear this, and they'll go out and play harder just to prove us naysayers wrong.
All right, we'll see. And I know Chip Kelly, you know, his back was to the wall today, whether he was going to leave. And, you know, he said, no one's ever approached me. I'm not approaching. You got when your coach is having his name thrown through rumors like that, is that a tough thing for the players to constantly try to figure out whether he's with them or leaving?
Well, that definitely puts you in a position where when you're fighting to you know win and try to get into the playoffs and you know your team's steady thinking, well, shoot, he might not be here next year. It does wear on the team a lot. It you know the rumors in the locker room, you know, because these guys hear the same thing. So sometimes you say, is he all the way in? Is he all the way out? Look at the production. We're in his system, and his system's not working. You know, sometimes that starts, you know, turning some heads. And, you know, the fact that you don't have the interpersonal skills that Chip Kelly has to talk to his guys, those are the little things that don't happen when you're winning. But since they're not winning, it really puts in an awkward position in that locker room.
All right, Barrett Brooks, Breakfast on Broad and the crew, 6 to 8 on the Comcast Network, with plenty more as the Eagles get ready to take on the New England Patriots on Sunday. All right, brother, I hope you had a good Thanksgiving.
You too, man. Take it easy now, all right?